Turn, if you will, please, to Luke chapter 1. I want to read verses 26 through 38. It's time to share the Christmas story. You've heard it in music. Let's read it out of the Word. Luke chapter 1. Mary, did you know? She didn't until Luke chapter 1. Let's read how she found out. In the sixth month, God sent an angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. And by the way, in case you didn't know, we have Mary and Joseph sitting right here, third row. All right, wave, Mary and Joseph. All right, it's good to have them here. She's not a virgin. Two daughters, all right. You're welcome, Joe. A descendant of David, the virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You have found favor." Some translations read it, "You have found grace with God." Those are the very same words that Noah had heard a few thousand years before. "Noah, you have found grace in the eyes of the Lord." The flood was sent to give earth a new start. And what a flood could not do, a baby would do. Mary, you found favor, grace with God. You will be with child. You will give birth to a son. And you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great. And he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end. "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." This was not a question of disbelief on Mary's part. This was an honest question. "I don't understand how this can happen. How can I be pregnant? I've never known a man." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." I find this verse somewhat interesting. Mary's informed that she's pregnant. She says, "I don't understand how this can happen." And so the angel tells her, "This is going to be done by the Holy Spirit. And let me give you testimony of another miracle. You are confused how a virgin can be pregnant. You know your old Aunt Elizabeth? You know your old Uncle Zechariah? They've never been able to have children? They're having a baby. So just as a barren old woman can miraculously have a child, so a virgin young woman is going to have a child. Now, Zechariah is the true father of your cousin. But the father of your son is God himself." Is God himself. And notice Mary's response. "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." And the angel left her. What God looks for in any man or woman, any boy or girl, is the same response that Mary gave. To whatever God wants to do in you, can you say, I'm available? Do with me, God, whatever your plan is. I love Christmas. I don't know if you know that about me, but I love Christmas. Christmas just might be the original truth is stranger than fiction event. Sometimes we don't know what to do with truth when it sounds stranger than fiction. So sometimes we think we've got to help it along a bit. And we either make up a story, lie, or leave off part of the story. Reminds me of a story I just recently read about a police officer who pulled a guy over for speeding, and they had the following dialogue. Officer, may I see your driver's license? Driver, I don't have one. I had it suspended when I got my fifth DUI. For those of you who don't know what a DUI is, that's driving under the influence. Officer, may I see the owner's card for this vehicle? Driver, it's not my car. I stole it. This car is stolen? Driver, that's right, but come to think of it, I think I saw the owner's card in the glove box when I was putting my gun in there. There's a gun in the glove box? Yes, sir. That's where I put it after I shot and killed a man who owns his car, and I stuffed his body in the trunk. There's a body in the trunk? Yeah, yes, sir. Hearing this, the officer immediately called his captain. The car was quickly surrounded by police, and the captain approached the driver to handle this rather tense situation. Captain, sir, can I see your license? Driver, sure, here it is. It was valid. Captain, whose car is this? Well, it's mine, officer. Here's the registration. Captain, could you slowly open that glove box so I can see the gun that's in it? Driver, yes, sir, I'll open it, but there's no gun in it. Sure enough, there was no gun in the glove box. Captain, would you mind opening your trunk? I was told you said there's a body in it. Driver, no problem. Trunk opened, no body. Captain, I don't understand it. The officer who stopped you said that you told him you didn't have a license, you stole the car, you had a gun in the glove box, and there was a dead body in the trunk. Driver, yeah, and I bet he told you I was speeding too. Truth, stranger than fiction. Sometimes we tend to exaggerate just to make our side of the story look better. You see, Mary could have concocted a story or simply told a lie to explain her circumstances. But she didn't. She accepted God's plan, and part of accepting God's plan was knowing that there would be ridicule for her life. She was uncertain at this point how Joseph was going to handle the news that the woman he was eventually going to be married to was going to have a baby. She accepted the plan. She told the truth, though it certainly was stranger than fiction. Have I mentioned that I love Christmas? I love the lights and the decorations. I love the food. That's obvious. And the fun. I love the giving and the getting. I love the Hallmark movies and White Christmas. You gotta watch Journey Back to Christmas. If you haven't seen it, new premiere, I think it's on tonight, I think. Check out the Hallmark Channel. I love new books, like Max Licato's new one this year, Because of Bethlehem. It gives us some fresh thinking about Christmas, and I stole a few things from him today. It's also a season, Christmas is a season that prompts so many questions. We had a child in one of our Sunday school classes just last Sunday ask his Sunday school teacher, who's Santa really and where can I find him in the Bible? We get other questions at this time of year. How many wise men were there? You know, we sing a song of we three kings, all right, but how many were there really? Here's what I know. There was at least two. Otherwise, it would have been just a wise guy rather than wise men. Okay? Another question. Why didn't Joseph make reservations? Then we wouldn't have had a problem with no room in the inn, all right? What's the big deal about baby Jesus? I mean, why does the world, check it out, go to any country in the world, Google it right now and see what's going on. There are folks who are celebrating Christmas. You see, the babe of Bethlehem prompts a lot of questions, and I also believe offers some really good answers. Here's one of the answers I love most that come out of the questions about Christmas. And that's this. God knows what it's like to be you and me. God knows what it's like to be a human. Because of Bethlehem. Because of Bethlehem, we have a friend in heaven. Because of Bethlehem, I have a Savior in heaven. Because of Bethlehem, Lucy Best is home in heaven. Christmas begins what Easter celebrates. Do you understand? You and I would not be dressed like this. The sanctuary would not be decorated like this. We would not be listening to music like this if it wasn't for Easter. We do not celebrate Christmas because a Jewish boy by the name of Joshua was born in Bethlehem. There have been hundreds of Jewish boys by the name of Joshua born in Bethlehem. But only one of them, 33 years after his birth, was crucified, died, and 3 days later rose again from the dead. Easter is what validates the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem. The child in the cradle became the king on the cross, and because he did, all the bad marks that could be on my record have been erased. Why? Of grace. The offer of God to us has no fine print. Jesus didn't say, hey, you go clean up your act, and when you get things straightened out, come see me. Jesus said, come just as you are. And if there's anything in your life that needs to be cleaned up, we'll take care of it. You see, it's not my grip on Christ that matters as much as his grip on me. And he wants to hold you and me tightly to this life. I'm filled with all kinds of bizarre and peculiar kind of questions. What do you do at an elevator? When you approach an elevator, what do you do? How many times do you push it? Yeah, one person said once. Everybody else started laughing. You just keep poking it, don't you? The lights lit up and you just hit it. If it doesn't get there fast, I've seen Joe do this. Boom, 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 boom. Will it get here faster? Why do we love the front seat of a bus and the back seat of church? We call them back row Baptists where I came from. Why do we pierce holes in our bodies and hang jewelry from them? I'm not opposed to piercings, all right? Just why? Why do we ask for instructions and then argue with the person who gave them? That's really true about directions. Okay, here's one. What purpose is a necktie? Yeah, think about it. What purpose is there for a necktie? Worn them all my life. You see, rational behavior is not one of the human trademarks. But if you want to see people on the edge of insanity, just watch the way our families treat our babies at Christmas time. As you know, I'm a new grandpa. First Christmas. That was Bo up here, by the way. All right? That's my grandson. Isn't he cute? Isn't he cute? He is precious. But think about this for a minute. Think about how we treat grandbabies and babies at Christmas time. The poor child has no warning at all. They're just starting to recover from the slide down the birth canal when the family begins decorating them as if they were a puppy in a dog parade. Red furry stocking caps, white balls on the end, goofy elfy shoes that curl at the toes. And then when this baby becomes a teenager and wears sagging jeans and sports a tattoo, we're going to groan at the sight of them. It's our fault. We started it when they were babies. But put a six-month-old in suspenders and reindeer antlers. That's so cute. And think about the gifts that we give our babies. The little one can't get out of her crib, and earnest mommy has her hooked on phonics. They can't even walk without help, and Grandpa gives them a Louisville Slugger baseball bat. I hope you don't mind, but I've already bought it, Katie. I've already bought it. And all the pictures we take of them, chewing on ornaments, sleeping under the tree, on Santa's lap, Santa with a wet spot on his lap, all the peculiar pictures. We fuss over our babies. Bring the baby in a room and notice how everything changes. Grandma reaches up, Grandpa wakes up. Conversations shift from politics and presidents to Pampers and pacifiers. Amen for that. This time of year, babies take center stage. And shouldn't they? Is not Christmas the story of a baby? Lakato wrote these words, "Heaven's seed entombed in Mary, minuscule yet mighty, a fetus yet a force. God descends a birth canal, born. Creator cradled in Bethlehem's barn, an infant yet infinite, asleep yet a king. God gurgles in mama's arms, baby born." This is the Christmas moment that shaped all the other moments that would follow. On a starlit night in the company of sheep and cattle and angels and a bewildered Joseph, Mary's eyes fell upon the face of her firstborn son. She was tired. She has been in pain. She was ready to put her head on the straw and sleep the rest of the night away. But first, Mary had to study his face. She needed to wipe the moisture from his mouth and feel the shape of his chin, to be the first to whisper, "So this is what God looks like." People have always wondered about the image of God. Societies have speculated. Tribes have cogitated. We've reached a variety of conclusions about what God must look like. God has been depicted by some, like in the Old Testament, as a golden calf. Others, he's a violent wind. Some, he's an angry volcano. To some, God wears wings. He breathes fire and he eats children and he demands penance. We fancied God as being ferocious or magical or fickle or maniacal, probably most as indifferent. He's a God by some to be avoided, by others dreaded, and some to be appeased. But never in our wildest imagination did we consider that God would step into our presence as a baby. Would you have planned it that way? If you were God, would you have stepped into this world through a birth canal? I doubt it. John describes it this way. Matthew and Mark, they give us the details. John gives us the theology. John says, "The Word," capital W, Logos, the Word, God Himself, the one who spoke by the word of His mouth all creation into existence. The Word became flesh, and He lived in our presence, yet without sin. The Word of God, not a whirlwind, not a devouring fire, but two single cells, a fertilized egg, an embryo, a baby. Do you realize placenta nourished God? An amniotic sac surrounded him. He grew to the size of a fist, and then his tiny heart divided into four chambers. God became a man. Jesus entered our world not like a human being, but as a human being. God became one of us and He lived with us. He endured puberty and pimples and hot weather and grouchy neighbors. God became a human being to His very toes. He had suspended the stars in space. He had hung the moon where it needed to be. He had splashed the seas in their locations, yet He put a lip lock on a breast and He slept in hay in a manger. Years ago, a school teacher asked some elementary students, "What questions would you ask Mary if you could?" out of the mouth of children are some great questions. Here's what some of them ask. Mary, were you scared of not doing a good job? What was Jesus' first word as a baby? Mary would say, Mama, confident. Was he beautiful? Did he ever get sick? Did Jesus ever misbehave? Did he have hair when he was born? What was his favorite food? Did you feel holier? Did Jesus ever ask you for a pet? All of these are legitimate questions and many more that we could come up with. The fact that we can ask these kind of questions raises one greater question. Why? Why such a journey for God? Why did God stoop so far to be with us? We sing a hymn around here, a chorus, a worship hymn. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. And then do you know what the next words are? You came from heaven to earth to show me the way. From earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Why did God stoop so far? I think the chief reason is this. He wants you and me to know that he gets us. Ladies, I should not do this. Why'd you marry the man you're married to? Did he get you? Did he understand you? Did he act like he was listening to you? I probably just started a fight, didn't I? Probably so. It's why you've made a commitment to each other. Finally, somebody gets me and accepts me the way I am. You see, Christ understands how we feel. Jesus Christ has faced what we face, not as God, but as man. Jesus is not out of touch with our reality. He's been through weakness and testing, tempted in every single way, just like you and me. So let's walk right up to him, and let's receive from him what he is ready to give. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 and 16 say it this way. Therefore, since we have a great high priest, who's that? Jesus, the baby born of Bethlehem, came to be prophet, priest, and king for us. He has gone through the heavens. Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith that we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he didn't mess up. He didn't sin. Let us then do what? Approach the throne of grace. How? With confidence, with our questions. For what purpose? So that we may receive mercy and find grace and get help in our time of need. This is what he offers to us. Take the mercy, receive the grace, accept the help that he offers to us. Since we know he understands, we can boldly go to him. Because of Bethlehem's miracle, we can answer these fundamental questions which plague us all. Does God care if you're hurting and sad? Look at the tear-streaked face of Jesus as he stood outside of Lazarus' tomb, and you'll know that he cares. In fact, in John chapter 11, you'll find the most memorized verse in all the Bible, and it tells us that he cares. You know the verse? Jesus wept. Can you all say that out loud with me? Jesus wept. You just learned a memory verse. Okay? You just learned one. John chapter 11. And it reminds us, it tells us that God cares when I'm sad. Does God notice when I'm afraid or scared? You could go to John 16, verse 16, and note the resolve in the eyes of Jesus as he marches on top of an angry sea through a storm to rescue his friends and to calm their fears. Does God know if I'm being ignored or rejected? Find the answer in compassion-filled eyes of Jesus as he stands to defend an adulterous woman in John chapter 8. A group of religious elite men. Here's the thing that always bothered me about the story of the adulterous woman. Where was the adulterous man? I mean, when they caught her, the scripture says they caught her in the very act. That means there was a man there. It was one of those men who probably brought her to Jesus and accused her. Why was it wrong for a woman to be involved in adultery and not wrong for that man? That's called hypocrisy. And it's what the world hates about the church, and it's what disappoints God most about his church, is our hypocrisy. But does God notice when I'm ignored or rejected? Notice he did not condone her adultery, but he forgave her adultery. And he said, go and sin no more. You're forgiven. Where are your accusers? They had to run because they stood guilty in the piercing eyes of Jesus. And Jesus said to her, go, sin no more. Jesus radiates God's own glory, and during his life he expressed the very character of God. You can read that in Hebrews 1:3. Jesus stated himself in John 14:9, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Anybody who's seen me cry, that's my Father crying. Any of you who've seen me laugh, that's my Daddy laughing. Anybody who's seen me determined, that's my Father being determined in me. Would you like to see God? Then go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and take a close look at Jesus. And you will see God in the man, Jesus. As Major Thomas has said from this stage on numerous occasions in the past, Jesus Christ, never ever less than God. Never ever more than man. In 1926, George Harley found a medical mission among the Mano tribe of Liberia. The locals were receptive to the doctor, and they helped him construct a clinic and a chapel. Eventually, Harley treated more than 10,000 patients a year, and during the first 5 years, not one person from the tribe visited the chapel. Shortly after the doctor and his wife arrived, she gave birth to Robert, their first child. The boy grew up playing at the edge of the forest. He was the apple of our eye. Harley later said, oh, man, how we love that boy of ours. But one day, when Bobby was about five, his daddy looked out the window of the medical dispensary and saw Bobby playing. He was running across the field, but then he fell, and he got up, and he ran some more, and he fell again. But this time, he didn't get up. So I ran to him, and I picked him up. His body was feverish. I held him in his arms, and I said, son, don't worry. Your daddy knows how to treat this tropical fever. He's going to make you better. Dr. Harley tried every treatment he knew, but nothing helped. The fever raged. In short order, the disease took the boy's life. The parents were distraught with grief. The missionary went into his workshop and he built a coffin. Harley placed his boy, his son, inside and he nailed the lid. He lifted the coffin on his shoulders and he walked towards the clearing to find a place to dig a grave. One of the old men in the village saw him and asked about the box. When Harley explained that his son had died, the old man offered to help him carry the coffin. Dr. Harley told a friend what happened next. Here's what he wrote. So the old man took one end of the coffin and I took the other. Eventually we came to the clearing in the forest. We dug a grave and we laid Bobby in it. But when we had filled the grave, I just couldn't stand it any longer. I fell down on my knees in the dirt and I began to sob uncontrollably. My precious son was dead. And there I was in an African jungle 8,000 miles from home and relatives. I felt so alone. But when I started crying, the old man cocked his head in stunned amazement. He squatted down beside me and he lifted my chin and he looked at me intently. And for a long time, he sat there and he listened to me cry. And then suddenly he leaped to his feet and running back to the trail through the jungle to the village, screaming again and again at the top of his voice, white man, white man, he cries like us, he cries like us. That evening, as Harley and his wife grieved in their cottage, there was a knock at the door. And Harley opened it, and there stood the chief and almost every man and woman and child from the village. They came back again the next Sunday, and they filled the chapel to overflowing. They wanted to hear about Jesus now. Why? Because a doctor who could heal their sick was not a god. He was a man. Just like them, he understood them. Everything changed when the villagers saw the tears of the missionary, and everything changes when we see the face of God. He came with tears too. He knows the burden of a broken heart. He knows the sorrow this life can bring. He could have come as a shining comet or a voice in the clouds, but he came as a person. Does God understand you? You bet he does, and you'll find the answer in Bethlehem. Gaze where Mary stared. Look into God's face and be assured, if the king was willing to enter the world of animals and shepherds and swaddling clothes, don't you think Jesus is willing to enter your life? He took on our face in the hope that we would see his. One final story, and we'll wrap up today. In one of his books, Jess Moody tells of meeting Rose Kennedy. You know that name, don't you? The mother of John F. Kennedy. He met her many years ago in a Bible study that he was teaching. That night, he challenged his hearers to make their hearts ready to meet the Lord, because life is short for us all, and no one knows what the future may hold. When the meeting was over, Rose Kennedy spoke to Jess Moody privately. She said, "I've done what you're talking about tonight." She went on to say that as a young bride, she had been enamored with the power of money. She became selfish, living for her own desires. Then she gave birth to a beautiful baby girl, and soon it became apparent that something was wrong with her daughter. Medical tests revealed that her daughter had been born with severe mental retardation, would have to be institutionalized for her entire life. Rose Kennedy said that she and her husband were devastated by the news. The devastation turned eventually to enormous anger against God. "How could you have done this to us?" The anger became a kind of corrosive bitterness that drained every bit of joy from her life. One night, she and her husband had been scheduled to attend a social gathering. They decided at the last minute not to go when she realized that her anger had consumed her. She was afraid of what she might do or say if somebody asked about their daughter's condition. And that's when it happened. A maid who worked for the family spoke to her. "Mrs. Kennedy, I've been watching you for the last few weeks, and I see how angry you are. If you don't do something, it's going to ruin you. I think you should pray this prayer. Oh, Lord, make my heart a manger where the Christ child could be born. Make my heart a manger where the Christ child can be born." Rose Kennedy told Jess Moody that she was so angry she fired the maid on the spot. But that night when she went to bed, she couldn't sleep, tossing and turning. She couldn't get that simple, simple prayer out of her mind. Finally, she knelt by her bed in an act of deep surrender. She prayed, "Oh Lord, make my heart a manger where the Christ child can be born." In that moment, in the depth of her darkness, when she cried out in anguish, God heard and God answered her prayer. "I've always been religious, you know. I'm a Catholic. I've always believed in Jesus. But that night, it was different for me. On that night, I opened my heart to Christ in a new way, and my heart did become a manger where Christ could be born in me." You see, love replaced the anger that had gripped her soul. And the rest of the story is this. She rehired the maid who stayed with the family until she died many years later. Some who are here today, you might need to pray that same prayer of Rose Kennedy. Perhaps you've been religious, maybe a religious Catholic or a religious Baptist, and no doubt you believe that Jesus is the Christ of Christmas, but for some, that belief has never led to a moment of personal commitment. It's possible that in these days leading up to Christmas, anger, worry, fear, doubt, and other distractions are draining all the joy from your heart. So this is the invitation from the Lord to you. Open your heart and say, "Lord, make my heart a manger where the Christ child can be born." Let's pray. And maybe some of you need to pray that short prayer. Why not do it this morning? Our Father, thank you for the message of Christmas, but most important of all, thank you for the person of Christmas, the one whose name is Jesus, the one who the world could see and touch and handle and listen to. And Father, today we can read about and discover, and we can, as we read your word, feel your presence, sense your truth, and may we respond to it. And Father, if there's one or two or several who've been religious, or maybe they've been so irreligious they've been mad at you, they need to pray a prayer much like Rose Kennedy did in the late night hours of her home. Lord, make my heart a manger where Jesus Christ can be born in me. Thanks for hearing Rose's prayer. Thanks for hearing our prayers today. In Jesus' name, amen.